Selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. So we are no longer slaves to sin. Amen. For when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. That's why we can come to Him in worship today. That's why we can come into His presence today, because He has paid it all in the cross. And you don't have to do it anymore. He has done it for you. His blood has been spilled for you. And therefore, we were washed clean from the sin of this world. Amen. So why won't we declare worship today?
Jesus. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I'll see Jesus. And on death through life, I will sing your praise. Wonder of your grace. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I'll see Jesus.
from death to life, I will sing your praise in the wonder of your name. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise in the wonder of your grace. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. From death to life, I will sing your praise in the wonder of your grace. How my soul will sing your praise in the wonder of your grace. How my soul will sing your praise. How wonderful, how glorious my Savior's call.
For the promises you've kept and every need you've met, Lord, I'm so grateful. You were with me every step, and I never will forget. When I think of how you blessed me, how your hand has never let me go, never let me go. You have been so good to me, God. I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been, so good to me, God. I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been. I call you Savior, for the blood that washed me clean, for the wrongs that you've redeemed. You're able, and my eyes don't have to see. one more reason to believe. 'Cause when I think of how you blessed me, how your hand has never let me go, you've never let me go. You have been so good to me. God, I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been. So good to me. God, I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been.
Father, you have been so good to us. Father, we immerse ourselves in your presence today. We immerse ourselves in your deep love. And we want to remember what you have done on the cross. And that's why we worship you today, God.
Standing here in your presence, in a grace so relentless, I am won by perfect love, wrapped within the arms of heaven, in a peace that lasts forever, sinking deep in mercy seat. I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and all my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, your love.
mercy on me. Lift my head to see your glory, Lord of all. So beautiful. Here in you I found shelter, captivated by the splendor of your face. My secret place, I'm wide awake, drawing closer by grace, and all my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, I'm wide awake, drawing closer by grace, and all my heart is yours. And all fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, your love. Your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. Your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and all my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, your love.
Your face is all I seek. You are my
face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you. Your love's so deep, Lord. 'Cause your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life.
We want you, Lord. We're all singing today for the audience of one. This whole thing that's taking place isn't for your entertainment. It's for Him. You're not the audience watching this. We all are singing to Him. He's our only audience today. Jesus, the reason why we've come today is to have an encounter with you. And in everything, Lord God, about our lives, we want to make sure that we can be presented faultless before you. We want to sink deep into your love. The world's so busy that it distracts us to the point that you are ignored, except when we have emergencies or when we're in a sick bed. But today, we're making a decision as we enter into February. I will live different from ever before. And I'm gonna rise to another level of serving you in every area of my life, how I live, especially when no one is looking. In Jesus' name, amen. The ushers are in the aisle today. We're coming to the Lord's table for communion. As the ushers distribute the elements, I want to make sure that you hold on to the elements. Please. I want to make sure that you hold on to the elements and we'll eat and drink together. Now, oftentimes in church, you might just have a piece of bread, something that represents His body. But here we've got a representation of the bread and the wine. And as you come before the Lord today, I want you to hold on to those elements, and we're all going to eat and drink together. But while everybody's waiting for their turn to receive, just a little bit of history why we're doing this. Might be a little bit different for you than how you're used to it. But understand this, the Last Supper, Jesus said, as often as you eat and drink of this, do it in remembrance of me. How many of you know you and I can make promises and we forget real easy? Hello? Yeah. Have you ever made a promise that, God, I won't do this again. God, I'm going to do this. And God, from now on. But then you didn't do it. Because He knew that human nature makes promises and we easily forget. But why was there a Last Supper in the first place? It was the Feast of the Passover Lamb, an annual event where Israel would celebrate that moment when God delivered the Israelites from Egyptian slavery. That was a time when they were crying out 400 years in slavery, asking to be set free. And after a multitude of 10 plagues, one after the other, God finally set them free. And the way it was done was there would be death of the firstborn in every household, whether animal or human, whatever's the eldest in the house, it would die. That was a curse. But God said to the Israelites, told Moses, take a lamb, sprinkle that blood. Let the people sprinkle the blood of the lamb on the lintel and on the doorpost. And when the angel of death would see that, as the angel of death would go throughout Egypt, killing the firstborn, every time the angel would see there was blood on the door, on the lintel and on the doorpost, the angel of death would pass over to the next house. That's why we call it the Passover. And so Israel would celebrate that every year. Every year they would recall that time that God set them free from sin and slavery. They escaped Egypt to spend 40 years in the wilderness and later on step into the promised land. Every year after that, they would celebrate the breaking of bread and the drinking from the cup. It was a representation, a remembrance that God had set them free. By the time you come to the New Testament, Jesus is in the story now. Jesus is the Lamb of God. And his crucifixion happened on the feast, on the eve of the feast of the Passover lamb. Meaning to say, he was the Lamb of God. He was to be the lamb whose blood would be shed. And on the lintel and on the doorpost, but this time it was a cross. And he is still the way. A door is the way in. He's still the way in to the presence of God. And little did they know that that celebration that they did for generations, year after year after year, was in preparation for the coming of the true Lamb of God who would take away the sin of the world. Your encounter with Christ, I want you to remember that. Can you remember a time that was the very first time I gave my life to Jesus? And it's not a religion you're giving your life to. It's not to a church. Religion doesn't save you, nor does church. It's a person. His name is Jesus. That's why he died. But why would he have to die? Because the penalty of sin is death. There's nothing humans can do to pay for their sin, because the penalty of sin is death. Unless there was someone innocent who would take your place. And that's what he did. He was the one who had no sin. He was innocent. And that's why he died on the cross. Not because just the people hated him, but because it was a payment for sin. And the Bible says to as many as believe that, if you believe that, salvation comes upon you. In other words, you can't work for it, can you? You can't whip your back, have yourself nailed. You can't do good works to pay for bad works, because the payment for bad works is death. It didn't say that the penalty of sin is good works. The penalty of sin is not prayer. The penalty of sin is death. And he took your place. And to everyone who believes, how many of you believe Jesus died on the cross? Okay, this side's, you're good. You're going to heaven. How about this side? You want to go to, how many of you believe Jesus died on the cross? And that death was payment for your sin. And so today, as you come before the Lord's table, it's a piece of a cracker, but it's just the representation we're talking about here. What he did was, are we gonna go? Yeah. What he did here was, on the night that he was betrayed, he lifted up the bread. He broke it and he gave thanks. Hang in there. Imagine having 12 disciples eating with them, knowing that they would betray him, sell him, leave him. Have you ever been to a restaurant wherein somebody you don't like or somebody who doesn't like you walks in? The whole meal is just upset by that one person's presence. But you know what Jesus did? He still ate with them. He didn't say to Judas, I know what you're gonna do. You're gonna betray me. I don't want to eat with you. But he still did. And that's because he gave every person a chance of his love. Amen. And after they ate and after they drank, you know what Jesus did? He washed their feet, even knowing that they would betray him. How many of us can actually be nice to people who are mean to us? And yet he did. He displayed that love. And so on that same night that he was betrayed, he lifted up the bread, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is given up for you. As often as you eat of this, remember me. Why was his body broken? So that you don't have to be broken. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. A lot of people just go through the motions and the ritual of communion, not realizing it represents what he did for us. And so today, as many as believe in him today, you eat of this bread in Jesus' name. Let's all eat together. And that same night he was betrayed, he lifted up the cup and he said, this is the cup of my new covenant. It was ratified by the shedding of his blood. The new covenant. You know what's new? Anybody here like new? How many of you like new? The Bible says His mercies are new every morning. Why a new covenant? Because it's better than the old, has better sacrifices, with a better promise, with a better testator, with a better blood that was shed. I love new. Anybody in this room love new? Yeah. Today is February already, your first Sunday for this month. It's a new month. It's the beginning of the week. It's a new week. Today is a new day. And as you come before the Lord, you know what He does when you totally surrender your life in walking and believing in Him? He makes, the Bible says, all things new. He even said, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus. And when He said, you must be born again, it's not a religion. He wasn't talking about a church. He said to be born again means to start yourself all over again, but not like the old person you were, but as a new person. How is that possible? Because He shed His blood and cleansed us of all unrighteousness. That means He took the record of your sin and deleted every history about it. And you can start afresh with Christ, even every day. And as He shared that cup with His friends, He knew they would betray Him, but He still drank with them. He said, I'll still pay for your sin, even though you might not want to walk with Me. So today we remember the time You died on the cross for us to pay for our sin. And we thank You in Jesus' name, amen. Can we all drink together, please? And then kindly pass the cups to the outer aisle. The ushers will be there to collect. And just remain standing for a few more moments and worship together with the team.
Take the bread of life, broken for all my sin, Your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice, to trade the sinner's sin for Your new covenant. Hallelujah. I live my life in remembrance. Promise I won't forget. I walk salvation's road with fear and trembling. Your way born as my own, as Christ is formed in me.
Thank you, Lord. We thank You, Lord. We thank You.
run my race. Remind me you're not finished yet. Hallelujah. 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 I live in remembrance.
Come on, lift up your praise. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus.
Lord, with our hands lifted before you, we just honor you today. Father, you have given your Son, Jesus Christ, to us because of your great love for each one of us. And it's just fitting to love you back. Love God with all of my heart, my soul, my mind, and my strength. And thank you, Father, for the opportunity to love you back, for giving me a chance in life where I can just honor you, bless you, give thanks to you, because you deserve all praise, glory, honor, and power belong to you. We thank you in Jesus' name. With the attitude of worship, you can be seated in the presence of the Lord. God loves us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, right? And along with Jesus Christ, he has given us all things. It is just right to love him back. Love God with all of our heart, with all of our strength, with all our mind and soul. And when we talk about strength, it is the fruit of our labor. We toil every day. It's not for us, but to give back what belongs to him. Can I hear an amen? Because we don't own anything in this world. Everything comes from our God. And it's just right and fitting to give back what belongs to him. As we give our offering to you, have the attitude of a very generous heart. Because God loves a cheerful giver. Don't think of this as coercion, but think of this as your love to God. When you give back to him, in whatever that you can give, it could be your time, it could be your talent, and plus your treasure. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you in the things that we give to you, our time, our talent, and our treasure. Thank you for loving us. And just, Lord, today, we just love you back. We love you. Because you first love us. Thank you for your great love. For your love is perfect. And cast all fears in life. We honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Give with a generous heart.
Good afternoon, City Church. Welcome to our announcement. Sa dugay na nga panahon, o milabay nga panahon, taod-taod na nga wata ka live announcement. Mga iksoon, bisag di ta iksoon, tawagun tumog iksoon, kaigsoon ta ni Jesus. O karong sa atong announcement, gikan sa City Church Center, sa atong firm foundation, if your spiritual foundation is not that strong and want more about Christianity, ayaw kalimut og appeal sa atong firm foundation karong February 17, Saturday, 8 a.m. sa City Church Center. Ug sa atong water baptism, ug kamo wa pa matuslob sa tubig, aduna kitay water baptism, February 24, Saturday, 8:30 a.m. Ug sa atong Sunday service, atong morning service, 10:15 a.m. sa Sky Hall, SM Seaside. Sa atong afternoon service, 4:28 p.m. diri sa Waterfront Hotel, ang hotel nga way water sa front, Waterfront Hotel. Ug sa atong Tuesday prayer, aduna kitay Tuesday prayer every Tuesday. Less prayer, less power. No prayer, no power. But more prayer, more power. So every Tuesday, aduna kitay prayer. 8 a.m. sa City Church Center. Sa young adults, kung ikaw dili ka bata, di po katiguang, napilong ka sa young o sa adult, aduna kitay young adult. 7:30 p.m. every Wednesday sa City Church Center. Sa atong recharge, kung ikaw sama sa battery nga nalubat na, apil na sa recharge this coming March 28 to 30. Sign up na sa lobby. Sa atong youth, kung ikaw dili ka young o dili po ka adult, kay nabilong ka sa youth, ayaw kalimut og appeal sa Youth Friday, 7:30 p.m. sa City Church Center. Ug diri natapos ang atong announcement gikan sa City Church Center. Daghang salamat ug make a difference in the city.
I'm not sure if we're AM or FM in this church. It's pretty down to earth. Hello, City Church. How are you today? Yeah, can you say hello to somebody to your left and right? Yeah, just greet them. The other one that you don't like so much, greet them as well. Say hello to everybody. All right, we're glad that you came early. It's fantastic how people assemble here in this place well before the time that we start. We appreciate you for that. We welcome you. If you're here for the first time, by the way, right at the corner over there, we have a guest lounge. And after the service, we'd love to meet the guests that you brought. We don't interview people because we're not interested in your past. We're very interested where your life is going in the future. Get to know us a bit so that we can get to know you a bit later on, okay? And welcome to everybody here. If you're watching us online, welcome as well. We appreciate that you're watching us online, except if you live in Lahug, you need to come here, okay? But let us know where you're watching from, any place in the world, and thank God you're connecting to us this way. Okay? Did you bring your Bibles today? That's pretty weak. Did you bring your Bibles today? No, you didn't. Yeah, because you think it's going to be on the screen, right? Anyway, Father, thank you so much for this time that we can come together. Beginning the week, praising you, assembling with people who believe in you as well. And I pray this month of February is full of surprise blessings for every person's life, even your household. God, I pray you bless everyone that's representing a home here, and every home and family be blessed. Let this February be fantastic and fabulous for each one of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, how many of you like surprise blessings, surprising his children? Okay, so expect that this month, all right? Anyway, I want you to turn your Bibles with me to 2 Kings chapter 6. 2 Kings chapter 6. And it's about the sons of the prophet of Elisha. That sounds pretty heavy. But don't you, anybody here love Cebu? You love the progress in our city? You love how we have so many buildings and malls, and we're half an hour away to the beach, another half hour to the mountains, half hour out of the city, and you're in the province. It's such a versatile city wherein you're not stuck in an urbanized setting, and yet in the busyness of this city, none of us like the traffic, right? Oh, you like the traffic? Okay, nobody likes the traffic, but it's the price that we're paying for unplanned progress. The nation is growing, this part of the world, East Asia, very progressive. I don't know why everybody wants to go abroad. The way to invest is right here in the Philippines, and I'm believing for great things for this country. Amen. The only problem is the Filipino. We got to fix that up, and that's part of what we're doing here. And so it's a progressive situation. When there's progress, when they expand the road, when they repave the road, there's a lot of inconvenience that takes place. And so I'm starting from chapter 6. And this is Elisha, and he had a bunch of followers. Elisha's a prophet who had a double portion of the anointing of the other prophet, Elijah. And Elisha, the sons of the prophets, said to him in verse 1. Watch where we're going with this. It said there in verse 1, and the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, see now, that doesn't sound good, see now. See now, the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to the Jordan and let every man take a beam from there, and let us make there a place where we may dwell. And so Elisha answered, go. Then one said, please consent to go with your servants. And he answered, I will go. And so he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed. So the man of God said, where did it fall? And he showed him the place, and so he cut off a piece, he cut off a stick, and he threw it in the water, and he made the iron float. And therefore he said, pick it up for yourself. And so he reached out, and he picked it up, and he took it. Father, take this word and make it alive in our spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. For those of you taking notes today, and those of you watching us online, we'd like to entitle this message, Don't Lose Your Cutting Edge. And by the time you leave this room, we're expounding just from this short story how it's so important to keep your axe sharp, okay? Reading all over again, I'm not going to read it all over again, but a synopsis of just what was the story was about. The room was not big enough. They needed to expand. And soon you're going to do that. We're going to expand to a second service. They needed to expand, so the sons of the prophets, these are students of the prophets, said, you know what, the place where we're staying with you is too small. Will you let us go to the forest? Let us go to the Jordan. Can we cut down trees? And every man will take back a beam. And so the prophet said, you go. But then they said, would you come with us? He said, I will go. And so off they went to the Jordan. They're chopping down trees. And while they were chopping, one of them, while he was chopping, the axe head fell off. And as it fell off, he said, alas, which in Cebuano is ayay. Nobody says alas anymore, right? Hang on, just give me 30 seconds to pray for you. Father, wake up the boring person behind me and beside me. In Jesus' name, amen. He said, ayay, because it was borrowed, okay? And so the man of God, the prophet, said, where did it fall? He pointed in the water where the axe head fell. And then the man of God took a stick, he threw it in the water, and the axe head floated. That's a miracle. Then he told the man, go pick it up. And the guy went into the water and picked up the floating axe head. Miracle. We're going to take that story and we're going to make it real and alive for you so that even when you leave this place throughout this week and this month, you're going to think about it, okay? Progress. They were in a situation of progress. As they were chopping, here it is. I got an axe for you. All right. As they were chopping, as each one was chopping, this thing's heavy, the axe head, the red part, fell off, okay? And the question is, when you're working like this, don't you think if you've been chopping wood that you can kind of tell that it's a bit loose? There's a feel towards what you do with your skill such that you kind of can feel that it is, something's not right. But what happened is the man just kept on working. And so the axe head finally falls off. You might be gifted, you might be skilled, but every skill and gift you and I have is borrowed from God. He lent it to us. And one day, each human being will stand before God, the Bible says, and he will judge great and small according to our works. And so we're gifted. All of us have a gift. You can even have the gift of smile. I mean, Lenny's like that. She just smiles all the time. They put people in hospitals for people who laugh all the time. But what happened here is that even if it was borrowed, you have to return it. Because you're not, in the Bible, they weren't Filipinos. They returned things they borrowed, okay? And so here's the point I want to bring with you on that. Don't you think the person must have noticed something's not right anymore, but he still kept on going? Sometimes we're like that in life. We know something's not right, but we just keep on going. Well, if you understand anything about chopping things or slicing things, all the ladies in this room or all the men that prepare dinner or lunch, whenever you're slicing meat, you understand that if the knife starts to get dull, you kind of feel it's getting dull, right? And so what will cause a dullness? When once upon a time you were really a sharp person, once upon a time, you were quick, you were sharp, your skill was great. But if you're not careful, you can lose things. So, what makes a person dull? Number one, look at this, abuse. When you have a gift, but you're just abusing it. You're overdoing things all the time. Number two, when you have a tool or a gift and you misuse it. When you're using a knife for a screwdriver, you're misusing the knife. In fact, most of us, if you look around, whenever you go to the restaurant, when people are slicing meat, they slice it with their spoon instead of using a knife. And that's just how, because they're misusing the spoon. The spoon wasn't meant for cutting. The second thing is misuse. The third thing where we can become dull, overuse. In other words, you just have used it too much. And it's time to sharpen that thing. I don't know about you, but when you look at even what we do, Sunday after Sunday, we come here, we preach, we prepare. The fantastic volunteers were here at midnight setting everything up. And then in the morning, all the wires are run, every light that you see, every speaker you see, hundreds and hundreds of meters of wires. Skillful people are doing that every Sunday. And what we want to make sure is you don't abuse your gift, you don't misuse your gift, and you also don't overuse your gift. So every once in a while, we roster you, change places, take a break, because we need to do that. But then in a busy city like Cebu, you can just get up every morning, shower your routinary shower, take your breakfast, take the same ride, go to work, do the same thing over and over again, and wait for the weekend so at least you can take a break. But then we do that over and over again, and we're chasing paydays, and after a while, kapuy na, and you start getting tired. You can get tired with work, no matter how much you love it, okay? You can get tired, ask yourself, have I become dull with my career? Do I find myself at the end of the day, week, or month lying down and, I'm getting tired of this thing. You get tired of relationships. Hanging out with the same people and there's just no progress in the relation. You can get tired in marriage. Don't say amen on that one yet. But you can get tired on marriage. It's just like the same old cycle all the time. Same old fight, same old nagging, same old thing over and over again. That repetitious lifestyle. You get tired of your commitment to God. Tired of church. Tired of serving. You can get tired in your spirit. The Bible says that sickness and disease a man can bear, but who can bear a broken spirit? When you're broken on the inside, yet you're strong on the outside, kapuy. So I've met 80-year-old people that have a zeal for life because they're excited about the things they're doing for other people or for God or for life. And then you can meet someone not 80, you can meet someone who's 18 and they're tired of life. They want to take their life already because they're just sick and tired of life. Everybody's running past them. Everybody's progressing and they're not. Or every relationship they get into, palpak. And once you have it successively, a young person like that can get discouraged and their life becomes dull. We're talking about keeping your axe sharp today, okay? In the spirit, as a Christian, you can get tired of church. And that's why we try to do church differently, because City Church is a church for people. Variation. You wanted something real and alive, and thank God the person beside you is alive. Might not look like it, but they are. Okay? And so you can see people, you can see our nation waiting for their Jeep on the side of the road, and just the average face of the Filipino or the average face of the Cebuano waiting for his Jeep just has the countenance and the posture of tiredness. Have you ever looked at somebody and saw how tired they were? I mean, we can be smiling and happy when we're around people, but what is your default face when you shut down all your personal apps of the day? And what do you look like? Because sometimes you don't even realize you're carrying stuff more than you can handle. But nobody seems to notice that in you because you come out and you seem happy, you seem lively, but on the inside, you're just really tired. Just tired. And sometimes you can look at your tired face and get tired of it. Just kapuya sa akong naong nga kapuy. So you can get sick and tired of being sick and tired. And by that time, the axe is so dull already. You're not excited about life. And I want to make sure that we don't fall into this trap. Ecclesiastes 10 verse 10. This was written thousands of years ago, but look at the wisdom behind this. If the axe is dull, if the axe is dull and its edge unsharpened, look, more strength is needed. Of course, because it's not as sharp as it used to be. So you have to swing harder. And because you're swinging harder, sooner or later, you're abusing your tool. And because you're having to swing so hard, the possibility of the axe head flying off is very high. And so look at what happens there. If the axe is dull and its edge unsharpened, more strength is needed, but skill will bring success. So if you're sharp about life, the chances are you don't have to work so hard. Do you find yourself having to work so hard? Do you know of a nation that is very well educated, very good academically, sharp, smart, but corrupt, And at the end of school, you can't even find a job that can pay your personal bills. Do you know of a nation that is just a lot of busy people, but they're not getting back the amount they're putting out? And afterwards, our option seems to be to look abroad. But if you look at things in life, our nation, as busy as we are, Cebu, it's just getting busier and busier. And the stress that you have to go through in an urbanized lifestyle. What you used to do was you get up, you'd leave the house for a certain appointment, but now you're having to move, you're having to prepare yourself 30 minutes earlier to give allowance for traffic. And if it's raining, you're going to have to go for an hour before that. It's taking longer and longer to travel. You get to work, you get the same pay, you work with the same people week after week, you look at the same face every day, and then what begins to happen is you're slowly getting tired, you're losing that sharpness, and you don't realize it anymore. You get up every morning, you pray the same prayer for breakfast, if ever we pray, bless us, O Lord, these thy gifts, O Lord, amen. And when you look up, it's the same, and God saying, how about sharpening yourself? How about getting more creative with God and sow some creativity into life? You know why it's not happening? Because people are tired. And so here's what happens. You can abuse a gift, you get tired. Misuse a gift, you get tired. Overuse your gift, you get tired. In fact, listen to this. If you use your gift, whether you like it or not, it will get dull. It will, just for the fact that you're using it. You have a knife, start using it sooner or later because you're using it, even using it properly. A knife will get dull. But then on the other hand, if you don't use a gift, it can get dull too. You leave an axe on its own, leave a sharp axe on its own. It'll corrode in time. It'll rust in time. Don't even use it. Just keep it. Just keep something and not use it. Some of us have gifts that we're not using, and we're losing the sharpness of it. If you have a gift to sing and you haven't sung for a long time, by the time you start singing again, the gift is there, but it's not as sharp as it used to be. If you're good at playing sports, you're playing basketball, you're really good with that, but you haven't played for a while, you start getting dull. If you play too much, you start getting dull. If you're abusing it, overusing it, misusing it, you start to get dull. So the point of the matter is, whether you do anything or not, you will get dull. You can love your spouse and you'll get dull. You not love your spouse and you'll get dull. In fact, if you have a garden and just neglect it, it'll become a jungle, whether you like it or not. Because it takes a constant maintenance to live in this world. Amen. You can take a bath. You can be as clean, squeaky clean. Take a good long bath. Not do anything, and tomorrow you won't smell fresh. Why? You live in a world that's decaying. Everything around us is decaying, and that's why we have to maintain it, right? You can tell when somebody hasn't maintained personal hygiene. They release an aroma that announces their presence in the room, right? And you can actually, by abuse or misuse or neglect, you can start becoming dull as a person. I want you to ask yourself today. It's February. We just started the year. We made our silly New Year's resolutions. Or maybe we got tired making New Year's resolutions because we realized it didn't work. And now it's February, and if you're not careful, you're back in the same style that you've been living last year. To stay sharp, stay sharp. That's what we're talking about. Don't lose your cutting edge. How do I stay sharp? I mean, how do I keep myself sharp as a person? How do I keep myself sharp in every role that I play personally in my life? And so if I'm using this as my cane, I'm misusing the axe. How do I stay sharp? Here's one thing you can do. Take a break can help. Sometimes you just have to chop, 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 and then take a break. You see, even God is so smart to tell us, to Israel, work 6 days, on the seventh day, rest. He says this to a bunch of slaves who were in Egypt for 400 years. Slaves don't know what rest is. In the top 10 commandments, rest is there. Sometimes the most holy thing you can do is rest. It's so important that God included it, that honor the Sabbath. On that day, don't work. But you see, we think, no, sayang ang day, I need to keep working. Work, work, work. God says, no, you need to rest every seventh day. Now, you can argue what day that is, but the important thing is understanding the pattern of working 6 days and then taking a break. When you take a break, sharpen yourself. Because people think, I got to work on the seventh day. No, you'll wear yourself out if you keep on working. And God is sharp enough and smart enough to tell us, on the seventh day, take a break. We forgot all about that. So now we think a break is, Sabbath is coming to a service like this. No, he says, you can work all you want, but know when to rest. And sometimes rest is the most holy thing you can do, and sometimes it's the best thing you can do. However, if you rest too much, you'll get dull. Right? Dong, tulog ka semana na ka, sige katog, you'll get dull as well. In other words, the proportion is 6 days work, 1 day rest. But then we think we're smarter than God. One of the best realizations any person can have in life is, God is smarter than me. And when God says work 6 days, rest 1 day, there's a reason why to do that, okay? So stay sharp, take a break. In fact, in a basketball game, when the opposing team is gaining momentum, you are tied at the end of the third quarter. You were leading for a while, but now you're tied. And now the opponent is gaining momentum. The best thing to do, if you're a smart coach, call a timeout. Timeout, guys. What do you do with a timeout? First of all, you break the momentum of your opponent. Amen. Secondly, you huddle and you talk to your team. You tell them what they're doing wrong. Tell them how to do it right. Tell them what the other team is doing. And then encourage them. Then put your hands together. They put their hands together, right? One, two, three, go. Let's go. And they go out to do that. Okay. That's with basketball. With volleyball, they do it every point they shoot. I mean, after every point, all the team comes together again and they hug each other. But the point being is, a timely timeout can save the game. A timely timeout can save your life. A timely timeout is like busy, busy, work, 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 timeout. I have to have my annual medical checkup. And we don't even do that, even if the insurance is free. Timeout means take a break from the routine. And so you can get work, you can get worked up in a busy city like Cebu. We came from Bacolod the other week, right? 3 weeks ago, we came from Bacolod, and the lifestyle is a lot, the pace is a lot slower there. And I said, man, I remember when Cebu was like this. You can park directly in front of the restaurant that you're going to eat in. When was the last time you parked at a restaurant right in front of it? No, we have to drop everybody off, you park somewhere else, and you walk. But in Bacolod, the lifestyle is a lot slower. And the traffic is moving. They said, ah, grabe na traffic bala. But it wasn't. It was, you want traffic? Come to Cebu. We'll show you traffic. And when you're cussing and cursing already with the traffic of Cebu, just go visit Manila for a couple of days and come back. And you realize, there's traffic, Cebu. It's so nice. It's relative. You see? And so as we're seeing that, when was the last time you took a time out? And I don't mean a vacation only. I mean just getting alone, thinking about yourself and asking, where's my life going? Where have I been? What do I want to do next? But you know what most people do? They wing it. They just keep doing the same thing, hoping one day, while they're walking, they find a bar of gold. Not gonna happen, okay? So, are you tired or are you weary? And we've explained this a couple of times in church in the past years. Tired and weary, there's a difference. Tired, you can play a basketball game, you can be tired physically, but you're not weary. You know who's weary? It's the other team that lost. They're tired and weary. Because tiredness is on the outside. Weariness is inside. Weariness is where you get the words worn out. Okay? So when you're tired, you can go to sleep. Rest a little bit early. Wake up a little bit later. Have a good night's rest. You wake up, you're not tired anymore. Right? But when you're weary, you can sleep all day, all week. You wake up and you're still weary because weariness isn't on the outside, it's on the inside, right? You can go into an office and you're weary already. Physically, you're not tired, but when you go into the office, just looking at the same face again, and you can get weary. Have you ever looked at somebody and got weary? Anybody ever looked at somebody? They haven't even said anything yet, but you just know if you're going to spend time talking to this person, their weariness will rub off on you, right? And what we're not, if we're not careful, we're winging it day after day after week after month after year and not realizing, I'm not tired, I'm weary, I'm worn out. That's what happens to an axe that's overused, abused, not used, misused. After a while, there's a weariness about it because you're having to exert more effort. And that's why, be wise, he said. Sharpen your axe and you'll get better results. And so when I look at myself, I can sometimes catch myself, man, I'm not tired, I'm weary about this. How many of you know there are people that can be financially weary? And at the end of everything, you know, there's nothing left. You can get weary. Amen. You live with somebody, sigig yo yo. In English, yo yo. I mean, it's just sigilag yo yo, and there's just a weariness about it. In fact, Proverbs will tell you, living with a contentious woman is like a constant drip. You ever heard that? There's a bucket and your faucet is leaking. Pluck, pluck, pluck. That constant naggingness of a contentious person is like a continuous drip. In fact, in Proverbs, it also says, better to live on the roof of your house than to live with a contentious woman. Pala'awayba. So if you ever drive by somebody's house and see them on the roof, grabi imo asawa no. So come to think about this, what that's doing is you're escaping from what's causing a weariness on the inside. Because you can be super healthy on the outside, but be weary inside. It's the same old thing over and over again. Okay? So verse 6 says this. So the man of God said, where did it fall? And I think that's a good question to ask ourselves. If you're weary, where did it fall? What's wrong with my voice? Where did it fall? Where did you lose it? When was the first day you started to lose it? Can you identify when things started to deteriorate? Financially, emotionally, mentally, maritally, spiritually, like in church. And so where did it fall, he said. You know where the fall began? In our Bible, you know how mankind decayed? All started in a garden. When God told Adam and Eve, don't eat of that fruit that's in the middle of the garden. Eat of every other fruit, but don't eat that durian in the middle of the garden. It'll taste like heaven, but smells like hell. But she still ate. And that's when they fell. That's where the fall began. And after that, every person that was born after Adam and Eve had sin in our lives. And that's why you can birth a baby and that baby's so cute, but then you can teach them all the right things, but the tendency is still to go to sin because it's inside each person, and that's why we needed a savior. Where did you fall? Where did I fall? Where did the weariness begin? You know what can make you weary? Sin can do that. Sin can make you weary, especially if it's habitual. And I think we all, in one way or another, have a struggle habitually. Sin can make you dull. Sin. In fact, Sin can make you look ugly. Come on, give me your best look. Sin can make you ugly, just continuous sin. I want to believe that when you have your high school reunion, whenever that happens, I want to believe that you're the best looking, youngest looking person because Christ is in you. Amen. Pray for that side. Something's really wrong with them today. I want you to believe that when you get together with your high school classmates, they're all saying, "Lo bata pa ni moy," and then you can say in your mind, "Look, guwang na sila," because sin can make you look ugly. You carry that stress and it ends with you, that'll weigh down on you. You wear a backpack and the devil will drop one marble every day. After 1 year, that's 365 marbles you're carrying in your backpack, and you won't even realize it. 10 years later, that's 3,650 marbles in your backpack. There are people who are stuck and laden with sin or responsibilities or problems or guilt, and it's weighing them down. They don't even realize, because it was so gradual. The stress built up so gradually. I want to believe that when you get together with your friends, your high school friends, if your friends are always smoking, everybody knows smoking is not good for your health. Yeah. If you really want to accelerate the deterioration of your health, come to the back of my car, I'll start it, get to the exhaust, and just suck up that smoke. And you want to know that whatever you're breathing that's not clean air, it's bad for you. It'll age you. Amen. And so sin will age you. You get into a drinking problem. I mean, you're just drinking every day, every day. It's going to hurt your liver sooner or later. You're gambling every day. The stress will get onto you. You're angry every day. You're carrying unforgiveness every day. And you know what? It'll make you look ugly. But the person beside you is not like that. They're looking good, which is a big difference from good looking, okay? So, here's what happens when you're carrying so much stress. Have you ever met somebody, they don't look fresh anymore? They're just stressed. And as Cebuanos, we're really loose with how we meet people that we haven't met for a long time, right? We're not, "Hi, hello." We're always, "Lo, nanambok lagi ka. Lo, tit lagi. Lo, lina lagi. Naupaw lagi ka." Can you please hold on the words? Right? You don't do that. Just hold on to that. Because be a lifter of people. Amen. So go home tonight. And after your shower, you do shower every night, right? After your shower, as you're drying yourself, without music, without anything, when you're on default, look at yourself in the mirror and say, "Kapoy, kapoy ko." When you should be able to say, "Ni gani mo." I mean, why? Sin will decay you. Neglect. Sin, if it's habitual, will age you very quickly. Unforgiveness is the same. Neglect. If you neglect something, it'll decay. You neglect family, it'll decay. Thirdly, routine will dull you out. Doing the same boring thing over and over again, that'll wear you out. And fourthly, successive failure. Every time you tried, you fail. Everything you do fails. After a while, you become discouraged. And after a while, you don't want to try anymore. And you'll be surprised how many people look good, but they're weary on the inside. How many artistas do you know that reached the pinnacle of success and fame and wealth? They had everything, but we were surprised when they committed suicide because they looked so alive on the outside, but they were dying within. You can be in a room like this. While everybody's singing, you can be dying on the inside. So what do we do if we're dying on the inside like that? How do we sharpen ourselves? Well, rest is good for your physical body. A vacation? Yeah, sometimes it'll help, just a break from the routine. Some people, their They're weary. They've got so many problems, they don't know what to do anymore. They go to their patron saint and pray to Miguel and get drunk with it. All that will do is just postpone the inevitable that you still have a problem. You can party. You can do everything you want to keep yourself busy, entertain yourself with music, with drugs, with smoke, with friends, hanging out, doing your hobby. But the fact of the matter is, when you're not doing anything, you're facing the reality of who you really are. And you need to be able to say, if you really are, I'm tired and I'm weary. I'm worn out. And so what do you do when you're weary? Matthew chapter 3, verse 10, Jesus himself said, look at this. Even now the axe is laid to the root, he said, of the trees. Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. You need to identify the areas of your life that's causing that weariness. And sometimes you can only observe the fruit. But if you're smart, Jesus said, lay the axe to the root. Because if you deal with the fruit, the next season, the fruit will come again. But if you chop it at the root, it won't come back. And so, when you come here on a Sunday, don't just sing. Don't just come here to do church and get an encounter. Talk to God. Slow down a little bit. Break the routine of a busy city life. And just when you're singing, God, I just need your help. I need you to touch me. And in a couple of months, we're going to have recharge. Our camp, we're going to have recharge. Oh my gosh. Thank you for the overwhelming response. That's our camp where we get out with the youth and the young adults. They spend a couple of days together just getting their lives right. Recharge. Have you been hiding under a rock? Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, NIV version says this. Jesus himself says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. Another version, heavily laden. Come to me, he said. He didn't say, go on vacation. He said, you come to me. You want a solution for your weariness? Come to me. He didn't say, go out with your friends. Go to Siargao. He didn't say that. He said, come to me, all you who are weary and are heavily laden, and I will give you rest. You see, every other solution you have will just solve the fruit part, but not the root. Because after your vacation, you take a break. Oh, I'm so weary. I need to take a break. Go on vacation. You come back and you're tired. Ever needed a vacation after a vacation? Anybody ever gotten tired from a vacation? You just arrive, and you took a break so that you won't be kapui, but you came back kapui, right? That's why every other person, especially my sisters from Manila, Joe, you're 30 minutes from the beach. Wow, that's so nice. I would go every weekend. No, Cebuanos don't like going to the beach every weekend. Because we know after coming from the beach, kapui. Why? Because the solution is Jesus. It's you getting into your bedroom and just getting real with life and saying, God, I'm tired. But it's going to take slowing down and it's going to take humility to admit it, that I am tired, Lord. I'm just so tired. In fact, I'm so sick and tired of being sick and tired. I always don't have enough. I'm always chasing. Whatever I do, it's a lot of work, but it's not bringing me the gratification. I'm tired. And if you're not careful, you get so worn out. The axe head will fall off. You're not just dull now. You lose it. Okay. And so he says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. 1 Peter 5:7. Peter writes and says, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. In fact, he cares for you more than you care for you. You know, weary people, they don't even care about themselves anymore. I don't care. That's real weariness. You know what that is? You've lost your axe head. You didn't just get dull. You got so tired chopping with a dull axe that you just got tired and it fell off. And as it fell off, you've lost it. Don't wait for that. That's why he came. That's why he came. And so, verse 5, but while one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water, and he cried out, and he said, aye, aye, master, it was borrowed. So the man of God, look at that, the man of God, because the Holy Spirit wasn't given yet. The Holy Spirit would come upon a person, on a prophet, on a king, on a certain person, and he would be gifted supernaturally. The man of God, the man of God, is representative of God. You need to run to God. You can run to him now. You don't have to run to the man of God. You can run to him, okay, if you're weary and tired. We get volunteers sometimes. They get worn out, and they'll say, brad, ita, rest usak ko. Every volunteer that rested, you know, most of them never came back to volunteer again. They're weary and they say, can I rest? Rest lang sa, don't put me on the roster. I just want to rest. And in our minds, we know what that means. Rest in peace. They're not going to come back. What they're doing is they want to take a break, but the real break they need is in a person. You don't need 3 months for a break. You need one touch. That's all. You don't need 2 weeks, 2 years to take a break. You need an encounter of the source of life. And you'll be refreshed instantly, just like that, if you know how to come to him. And so, in verse 6, the man of God said, where did it fall? I love the fact that he stayed connected to the man of God, these people. He said, look, we're going to cut down. Will you allow us to cut down some trees so we can expand where we're living? Yeah. Isn't that great? Whenever you have a plan, you present it to God and get God's approval. See, once you get God's approval, you're on the road to success. But then he says, will you come with us? And the man of God said, I will go. You make some plans, present it before the Lord. And once you get a yes from that, say, God, can you come with me on this? I can't do it by myself. The man of God came, and yet they still lost. He still lost the axe head. They went back to the man of God and said, who said in verse 6, put it up on the screen, please. 6, verse 6. So the man of God said this, where did it fall? And he showed him the place in verse 6. Where did it fall? You have to know where it fell. And here's the part you need to see. The solution of the man of God was strange. He cut off a stick and he threw it there, and he made the iron float. What a silly solution, but it still solved the problem. The axe head fell off, and they went to the man of God, and the man said, where did it fall? And he pointed to the place where it fell. You've got to know where it started. And so the man broke a stick and he threw it into the water and the axe head floated. Guys, iron doesn't float, okay? Okay, you're Cebuano, you're saying, ambarco de ay. Yeah, I mean a solid axe head will not float, guys. But that's the miracle right there. Because when you've lost something, oftentimes you'll need a miracle to take it back. You know what happened there? He threw a stick into the water and it raised the iron axe head. When was the last time you saw a piece of wood raise something that had sunk? When was the last time you saw a life that had sunk and a piece of wood saved it? 2,000 years ago, God saw the state of mankind. What a mess we were. In fact, you run your own life. You can make a mess of it. You know what God did? I'm going to throw a stick. I'll throw a cross right on the Golgotha, right on that Calvary. He threw a stick down, and he hung that on that stick, his son. And everyone who would look at that and believe in that would be resurrected and raised in newness of life. Your hope is in the Lord touching your life when you can identify that he's your only source of resurrection and refreshing. If you're weary today, you need to come to him in Jesus' name. Amen. And so there you go. The miracle happens. You look to the cross. He raises you up. He can restore every person in this room. He can restore the dreams that he gave you. Not your dreams, but his dreams. He can restore all the plans that he put into your heart. He can restore all of that. And so in verse 7 as we close, it said there, therefore, Elisha said, the prophet said, pick it up for yourself. And so he reached out his hand and he took it. Listen to that as we close. Where did it fall? Over there. Okay, I'll throw a stick. The axe head floats. The man didn't say, hey, prophet, can you pick it up for me? No. You do what you can do and let God do what you can't do. You can't do a lot of things. Let God do that for you. But the things you can do, you need to do it yourself. You can't always pray that God will do everything for you. He will do the things that are impossible for you, but what is possible, you must do. That's why some people say, Pastor, can you pray that I find a job? Makatrabaho ko, Pastor. Can you pray that I get a job? Okay, all right. Ni-apply na ka? Wala pa. So how are you going to get a job? At least do your part, right? Amen? Hello? A lady will come up to you and she's, okay, Store, can you pray that I get married? Yeah, but I wish I could say this, but I don't. But can you fix yourself up a bit? I mean, you're not at all attractive, right? I mean, people will run away from you. I mean, at least be pleasant. I mean, if you're not happy with life and you look unhappy, if you look like you're a dog about to bark, bite people, look at yourself. I mean, in other words, there are things that you can do that you can do. And there are things that only God can do. And you need to distinguish which is which in Jesus' name. Amen. So someone will say, Pastor, I'm not well. Taas kay ko cholesterol. Can you pray? Okay, nami parte iguman, Pastor, dagang lechon. Pray, Pastor, I won't. And it's just, no. You're going to die if you do that. Because you got to help yourself too. Amen. And so when somebody's sick and say, can you pray for me? No, I will not pray for you, but I will pray with you. It can't be we're praying for you and you're not praying for yourself. No, I'll pray for you and with you, but I'm not just going to pray for you. Yeah. So, ikaw mong good dig pray. Said, I've already lost enough praying for you. Can you? I've lost enough praying for you. Can you learn to pray for yourself? And we'll pray together, because two of us praying, we can join our faith. If two or three of you agree as touching anything, our Father in heaven will give it to us. Amen. So the answer to a lost axe is Jesus. The answer to a dull axe is you. Sharpen yourself. The answer to refreshing and a miracle in your life is Jesus. But learning to stay sharp is up to you. So Father, we bow our heads in prayer today. And we look into our lives. Close your eyes so you're not looking at the person's shoes next to you.
George, a bit stronger.
Yeah. Father, I want to look into my life. I can be young, but worn out. And I don't want to live like this. I want change. I'm sure there are people in this room, Lord, that want change. But the change has to begin with you wanting it. How many of you in this room can actually say, you know, kind of tired and weary? I'm tired and I rest and then I'm okay. But weary is I'm worn out. And you can be 11 years old and be worn out. Or you can be 91 and still be strong. Anybody in this room kind of feel, I am carrying a burden bigger than I can handle? Jesus said, cast your burdens upon me. It's too heavy for you.
Anybody in this room has enough humility and faith to raise their hand and say, yeah, I'm burdened. I'm carrying too much, Lord. Would you lift your hand, please? Yeah, you can do it higher than that. Anybody in this room is like, I'm weary, Lord. Nobody knows it. On the outside, I look strong. But on the inside, there's just some weariness in me. Anybody like that? Yeah. Lots of people. Lots of people. The answer is in Christ. And the answer is in your hands. Praise God. Anybody in this room are just living a life week after week, month after month, and year after year, and you're saying, you know what? I don't know where my life is going. I need to do something about this. Well, I want to tell you something. If you keep doing the same thing, you'll keep getting the same results. But if you want something you've never had before, you've got to try doing something you've never done before. And you know what the world will give you? They'll give you music, but it won't answer it. It will postpone it. They'll lie to you, and the devil will lie into your mind and ears and say, take your life na lang kapuinaka. No. That only kills your body, but your soul is still alive forever, and it suffers forever. Suicide's never the problem. Never the solution. Jesus Christ is the solution. I don't mean the churchy kind of Jesus Christ that's presented in most churches. I mean a personal relationship. Everybody, can we all stand up? And everybody who raised their hands, I'm going to challenge you to take that step, one more step. Life group leaders, I need you in front. Quickly. If you raised your hands, you're saying, Kapui, weary, can we just shortly pray for you? We won't embarrass you. We won't ask you to do something you're not comfortable with. But you come forward and let somebody pray with you. Not just for you. Let somebody pray with you. You come. You come. You come. You come. All the weary, you come. Yeah. Praise God. Come. Can you just give these people an encouraging applause for being humble enough to come forward here in Jesus' name. And everybody who's in front, just take one more step forward so that others can have room as they come. Keep coming. Don't be shy. All right, listen up. Listen up for a minute. Yeah, look up for a minute, everybody. Prayer can change things. Not the prayer of a person. It's when you actually release your faith and let Jesus touch your life. Amen? And we're going to lead you in a prayer. And I want you to release whatever it is. He says, you cast your burdens upon me. You know what cast is, right? Cast is not like this. Cast is like that. Put some effort into it. And say, I am sick and tired of my situation and I want a fresh start. That's why you're here in front, right? Amen? And as we lead you in prayer, I want you to release it out of your mouth. I don't want you to think it in your mind. Repeat what I say, but let it come from your heart. Amen? Amen? All of us. And then people will pray with you. Pray with us on this. Lord Jesus. Come on, talk to him. Everybody that's standing behind them, just encourage them as well. Lord Jesus, you are the source of life. I come to you because I'm weary and I don't want to live like this anymore. My tank is empty and I need strength from you. I need your encouragement. I need life to come inside of me once again. And so I lift up my hands before you today. Would you do that? I lift up my hands and it signifies what I'm surrendering. My life, my direction, my future. I don't know what to do next. And I want to release, come on, I want to release all my burdens and all my cares to you. I will trust in you that a miracle will happen. And the axe will float again. I will float again in the name of Jesus. I will rise again in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. People will come and pray for you and with you. And the rest of you, join in worship with this song. Would you do that? Make this song your prayer.
Cause you're all to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you.
Yeah.
People's hearts today. You said, if you draw near to me, I will draw near to you. We're going to dismiss the service. If you're a first timer, we'll see you at the corner. As we dismiss you, you that are in front that still want to be prayed with, you stay. We'll take time. If your friend is waiting with you, they'll wait for you outside. But Father, as we end this service, we call a blessing upon everybody that is standing at their seats. We call February a year, a month of favor. Favor in February for each one. May you go home tonight, shut the door, and talk to the one who loves you more than any human being can. And bless you with your life. Father, bless the people as they are dismissed today and as they go their way. In the name of Jesus, have a great week. God bless you, City Church. The rest of you in front, you can still stay. We'll still pray with you. Amen.
Hear you say that I'm your friend. 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel